Alô?
Som.
Bom, então nós vamos começar essa tarde com a fala de Isabel Serra, da Universidade de Lisboa, sobre Geometry and Physics in Poincaré's Philosophy.
Thank you. Thank you to be invited. And excuse me for my very bad English. I will read something in French, quotation of Poincaré and other authors. But I will try to speak English all the time. First, my outline. In the introduction, I will try to characterize the relationship between science and philosophy of the work of Poincaré. I think the connections established were crucial in his relationship, so then I will talk mainly about connections. Connections of differential equations with non-Euclidean geometry, group theory, celestial mechanics, in a very superficial way, because we had here to speak about that a lot, and other connections like topology and philosophy, conventionalism, and electrodynamics too. Here I have a geometrical schema, with shapes and colors, where differential equations play a central role, and from differential equations, connections born in the several connections, and connections born from other connections. That's enough to explain, but I will try to explain in detail with the words. First, I begin with a quotation of Laurent Rollet, because I think this phrase, in this phrase, I see an insightful new perspective about Poincaré's thinking. I read in French, but you have in English. Tout un faisceau d'indices plaide en faveur d'un ancrage de la pensée poincarienne au sein de la philosophie traditionnelle, c'est-à-dire au sein d'une sphère intellectuelle qui n'a pas forcément les théories mathématiques ou physiques pour objet d'étude. This phrase, the statement of Rollet's statement, lead to new insights regarding the work of Poincaré? I think so. Now I'm going a step further than Rollet by asking if was Poincaré a scientist inspired by his philosophical thought? If so, we can characterize the relationship between philosophy and science in Poincaré's work by saying that Poincaré's philosophy thought influenced his scientific work, which in turn would be a source on philosophical thought. To examine the issue, I will look at the history of some of his discoveries and inventions. I begin with the first works of Poincaré, in differential equation, two aspects, the global theory and its application in celestial mechanics, three-body problem and chaos, and another aspect, the theory of differential equation in the complex domain. Its connection with the group theoretic approach of Riemann surfaces, connection with the non-Euclidean geometry. Actually, at this point, Poincaré was thinking about the two subjects, which we have heard much talk about both subjects here. To view the connection established by Poincaré succinctly, are you using again geometry, Euclidean geometry? Is the first schema of connections, the connections between differential equation and non-Euclidean geometry and group theory, one aspect, and other aspect, differential equation to chaos through the global theory of the global study of celestial and celestial mechanics. I will read what Jeremy Gray tells us about that in his his PhD thesis. He says us that Poincaré was very interested in the global theory of differential equations, whether first order, real, or linear and complex. And what is very important, he says us that within 2 years, his work was to transform both subjects completely, opening up all new aspects of research in the one, and in the other, leaving little, it has been said, for his successors to do. And we can ask how and why Poincaré's work completely transformed the subject of the differential equations. The first aspect, the chaos, the celestial mechanics, and he gave the first definition of chaos, what we call chaos at present. I read in French, il peut arriver que des petites différences dans des conditions initiales un engendre de très grandes dans le phénomène final. Une petite erreur sur les premières produirait une erreur énorme sur les dernières. La prédiction devient alors impossible. We can use today this definition and to chaos. And the second aspect of differential equations in the complex domain. Gray, in another article, says that Poincaré helped open a fertile area for the newer methods of group theory and so displayed these methods to advantage in the study of problems in a central topics in contemporary mathematics. And we can ask with Gray and Walter how Poincaré was the idea of using the non-Euclidean geometry. The date of the first supplement make very clear that he's on boarding the Warschau bus at Kutans. I'm quoting now a very famous phrase of Poincaré that was quoted in the many articles and papers. Au moment où je mettais le pied sur le marchepied, l'idée me vint, sans que rien dans ma pensée intérieure parût m'y avoir préparé, que les transformations dont j'avais fait usage pour définir les fonctions fuchsiennes étaient identiques à celles de la géométrie non euclidienne. The quotation is in the 1908, but the event it's in 1868. And what was the source of Poincaré's views on geometry? Gray and Walters discuss a lot in his paper, in his three supplements on function functions, this problem. I cannot discuss very well there, but I have set this quotation from the three supplements. When he wrote his work on function functions, Poincaré already knew non-Euclidean geometries, although it is difficult to determine the origin of his knowledge. They add, it is clear that geometrical insight always guided his research. And this phrase, from La Science et l'Hypothèse, but that is quoted in the three supplements. In fact, what is a geometry? It is the study of the group. They add too that the theory of functions that Poincaré called Fuchsian, and now we call automorphic, lent the power of discovery of the non-Euclidean geometry whose interest hitherto seemed to be limited to philosophy. And the three supplements reveal how the discovery of the connection with non-Euclidean geometry enabled Poincaré to advance so rapidly in his research. Gray, in his PhD thesis, he wrote a great chapter about the work, Poincaré's work on differential equations, and he tells us, he speaks about the astounding clarity of Poincaré's mind, coupled with an almost equally dramatic ignorance of contemporary mathematics. Poincaré genuinely did not then know the German work. Totally ignorant of Riemann's work, he had come to construct Riemann's surfaces naturally from this continuous group. In his mind, this connected with linear differential equations, a topic much less interesting to Klein. Gray compared the work, the Klein's work and the Poincaré's work about the subject, and he, in his opinion, the group theoretic and Riemann surface theoretic aspects of the theory were developed jointly, but the connection with differential equations remained Poincaré's concern. This insight of Poincaré, so painful gained by Klein, testifies to the strong Walt Klein idea of mathematical unity at Upper Egypt. The paradox is that Klein, who had done so much to further non-Euclidean geometry in the 2870, did not appreciate it there. Now that we have seen these connections with the very important connection with non-Euclidean geometry, we will see another connection, the connection of non-Euclidean geometry with his philosophy, conventionalism in geometry, and conventionalism in physics, and the connection with electrodynamics, and also topology, a connection who came from differential equations. I don't know much about that, but I quote Nabonin, Philippe Nabonin, who tells us that we should see the origin of the topological questions to which he dedicated himself in the early work on the qualitative theory of differential equations. He talks about Stilwell, that Stilwell emphasizes the importance of the theory of function functions for the genesis of the topological ideas of Poincaré. And now, what concerns the philosophy of geometry. Scott Walter, in his PhD thesis, he spoke about that. He tells us a probable source of the philosophy of the geometry of Poincaré is in debates about the logical and the physical significance of non-Euclidean geometry from 1870 and 1880. And now, from conventionalism in geometry to conventionalism in physics. And I'm quoting Jérémy. He says, however uncertain and controversial the rest may be, we know at least that Poincaré's philosophy originated from his research in the foundation of geometry. In articles published in the last decades of 19th century and at the beginning of the 20th century, Poincaré extended the idea of conventionality and of convention to his analysis of the measurement of time and of what he called the principles of physics. Poincaré himself, he says explicitly, take a comparison with geometry when he spoke of physics. And I quote, si ces postulats, postulats de la mécanique, possèdent une généralité et une certitude qui faisaient défaut aux vérités expérimentales d'où ils sont tirés, c'est qu'ils se réduisent en dernière analyse à une simple convention que nous avons le droit de faire parce que nous sommes certains d'avance qu'aucune expérience ne viendra la contredire. Cette convention n'est pourtant pas absolument arbitraire. It's a very famous sentence of Poincaré. And I quote Heinzmann too, as I'm from the size difference in the mechanics as in geometry, Poincaré uses the same procedure to pass from the empirical laws considered as general hypotheses to the principles, including elements explicitly conventional. This connection is established by Poincaré, by Heinzmann, by Jérémy, And we will see now another connection of the non-Euclidean geometry, not to philosophy, but now the to electrodynamics and group theory. First of all, the notion of group proved to be crucial in the work of electrodynamics. Scott Walter tells us that extending his purview to the geometry of space, Poincaré held hyperbolic geometry and Euclidean geometry both to be adequate to the task of describing the physical phenomena. And Regnier, he talk about the l'essence du principe de relativité. He tell us that Poincaré showed the coordinate transformations with, he called Lorentz, define a group called Lorentz group. And the group of the global space-time symmetries for electrodynamics was completely derived by Poincaré. Regnier, too, you tell yet understanding that the principle of relativity can be deduced from the symmetry properties of the physical laws, Poincaré arrives at a version of the theory of relativity based on the group of Lorentz transformations. And also, the search for invariants associated with this group led to other results obtained by Poincaré, but also by Minkowski after reading the article by Poincaré. Also, Wigner talk about the relevance of the group concept, symmetry, and invariance principles in physics. Through the 20th century, the concepts of group, symmetry, and invariance principles have become essential in modern physics, especially in quantum mechanics. 5 minutes. I'm finishing. And I read what Feynman wrote in a book of popularization of physics, the laws of physics, and he spoke about symmetry, physics and symmetry. And I think Feynman did know much about the history of physics, but he knew that was Poincaré. He tells us in his book that the beginning of the study of symmetries in physical laws, that about this subject, he tells us it was Poincaré's suggestion to make this analysis of what you can to do the equations and leave them alone. And yet, it was Poincaré's attitude to pay attention to symmetries of physical laws. Now, we have the same geometric schema, where I begin. I think this is transformed about the words, after the words, because we see here all the connections I try to speak about, from topology, chaos, electrodynamics, non-Euclidean geometry and group theory, to conventionalism and to symmetry in physics. And I My conclusion is this network of interactions and influences could be established, probably because the research subjects were propitious, I don't know, but however, the successful construction of this network was mainly due to Poincaré's very specific way of approaching problems. Can we say then that he worked with his scientific knowledge as a philosopher, would with ideas? And that's all.
The questions will be at the end. Now we will have Maria da Paz.
Wait a minute. This is not a... Sorry. Okay. Yeah, that's it. Well, thank you, the organizers, for letting me to be here today. And thank you all for being here. Well, Poincaré's philosophy of physics has been characterized in several ways. For example, as partial nominalist, as conventionalist with neo-Kantian aspects, as structural realism, or even as pragmatism, just to name a few. But my aim here is not to provide another name to associate to his philosophy, but just to clarify one of its most basic elements, which is the facts. And many things have been said about convention as a key element in Poincaré's writings, but the constitution of science, to him, begins with facts. Mainly, well, I'm speaking about natural science, mainly physics and mechanics, and not about geometry and mathematics. So when Poincaré characterizes facts, he usually makes it in a dual way, and this is expressed in different forms. For example, in Science and Hypothesis, he speaks about elementary and complex phenomena. In Science and Method, he refers to simple and complex facts or phenomena. And finally, in The Value of Science, we have the most famous pair expressed as crude and scientific facts. And due to the time restrictions, I will focus only on the latter. This duality is not original from Poincaré, but is taken from Leroy's 1899 paper, Science et Philosophie. Poincaré uses this distinction between crude and scientific fact to reject Leroy's position and to better define his own one, trying to outline what a fact is, whether a crude or a scientific one. I consider that this is the most basic duality and the more fundamental one in Poincaré's account of facts. So from my point of view, the other dualities belong to later stages of scientific knowledge. At first sight, the pair crude and scientific fact may seem as a distinction between something given, the crude fact, and something constructed, the scientific fact. However, Poincaré insists on that this is only a division regarding different linguistic levels in the language in which facts are expressed. Therefore, the difference between crude and scientific fact is only a linguistic one. As he says, the scientific fact will never be anything but the crude fact translated into another language. But what is exactly the crude fact that we're talking about? Crude facts are empirical data, something completely given by experience. It is the phenomenon received by our perceptual means. Accordingly, it belongs to a domain of reality completely alien to human creation. Crude facts are outside us, and they constitute the raw material of science. It is some kind of external element in which scientific decision has no place. As a result, the origin of science for Poincaré is placed in experience and is given externally. So contrary to Leroy's nominalist philosophy, who asserts that facts are free creations of the observer, who who determines them by isolating them, one can defend that they are not invented by us, but imposed on us. So this is an example given by Poincaré himself, and says, I observe the deviation of a galvanometer by the aid of a movable mirror, which projects a luminous image or spot in a divided scale. The crude fact is this, I see the spot displays itself on the scale. So a crude fact is the record of an empirical datum. This could be the record of the data that we see in an experimental device, such as in the galvanometer example, or they could be records taken directly from nature. That is, without the mediation of any device, such as the sensation of darkness that we have in an eclipse. In this sense, I agree with Schmidt when she says that there is no difference between a direct observation and one mediated by an instrument or device such as the galvanometer. So the use of instruments or the conditions given to experiments by a scientific theory no longer gives rise, of course, to a pure in the sense of immediate observation, but it should allow a pure in the sense of a genuine observation, experiences being always defined by their relation to senses. Once the measurement is done through the mediation of an instrument and of theoretical conditions in the scientific sense, we can keep the result regardless of instrument and theory, so the facts will always remain a sense datum. Consequently, there is no doubt that science is constituted by records taken from experience by means of our senses. And those data are the crude facts, the raw material of scientific knowledge. As a result, I think that we can assert some kind of empiricism as the basis of Poincaré's epistemology. Nevertheless, these crude facts have a fundamental feature. They are particular and unrepeatable. Each one of them is different from any other possible fact. So the spot that I see in the galvanometer scale is unique, and I will not see that again. I will see analog spots that will give approximately similar marks in the scale, but never precisely that same spot. The same happens with the eclipse. The sensation of darkness that I have when an eclipse takes place is different from the sensation of darkness that I will have in any other eclipse, though it is similar. There are no twin eclipses that can have exactly the same grade of darkness, just like there are no two identical beams of light projected in the scale of a galvanometer. However, science is not made up of individual facts. For example, we don't take a single beam of light to establish a theory about the flow of electricity in a galvanometer. Besides, science contains empirical hypotheses that, according to Poincaré, are generalization of empirical facts, whereas crude facts are particular. How can the scientists proceed from the particular to general? By means of the scientific facts. As I said before, this is Leroy's terminology used by Poincaré to establish his own epistemology. But for Leroy, the scientific fact is a creation of the scientist, whereas for Poincaré, it is imposed by the crude fact. And this assertion fits well with these empiricisms that I talk about. And according to Poincaré, the transition from crude to scientific fact is a process of fixing errors. When I make an experiment, I should subject the result to certain corrections because I know I must have made errors. These errors are of two kinds. Some are accidental, and these I shall correct by taking the mean, and the others are systematic, and I shall be able to correct those only by a thorough study of their causes. The first result obtained is then the crude fact, while the scientific fact is the final result after the finished corrections. The result of that process is expressed in a linguistic level different from common language. It is the language of science, whose main purpose is to erase observational errors. In this sense, Poincaré states a linguistic difference between crude and scientific fact, and this marks an important feature of each one of them. Whereas crude facts are prior and independent from language, scientific facts are subsequent and depend on it. This does not mean, of course, that they are constructed by the scientist. As he states, all the scientist creates in a fact is the language in which he enunciates it. Crude facts underlie scientific facts, and that is what makes possible generalizations to be verified. By creating scientific language, by fixing the errors and ambiguities of ordinary language, that is, by purifying the ordinary language, the scientist establishes the way of expression of scientific facts. This is the reason why this fact is dependent on language. There are no scientific facts if they are not stated in a specific language. Actually, to be scientific, they have to be classified and specified, and that can only be done by means of the scientific language. On the contrary, the crude fact is given without being stated in a language. Accordingly, Poincaré asserts that the scientific fact is only the crude fact translated into a convenient language. What is the language in which crude facts are stated? It is the common language in which we say, I see a spot of light in the galvanometer scale. It is the language in which we state our observations taken from experience. In the transition from our observation to common language, we transform the crude fact in a certain way, in the sense that this fact loses its individuality. This happens because every statement of the common language can fit a multiplicity of facts, since we use the same words to classify experimentally analogous data. As he says, as soon as language intervenes, I have at my command only a finite number of terms to express the shape in number infinite that my impressions might cover. When I say it grows dark, that well expresses the impressions I feel in being present at an eclipse, but even in obscurity, a multitude of shades could be imagined. And if instead of that actually realized had happened a slightly different shape, yet I still have enunciated this other by saying it grows dark. In fact, when we classify the sense data by means of language, we start a process of generalization, because we dispense with the scientific features that characterize the specific features that characterize the individual phenomenon in order to keep what is common to other similar phenomena. We can say that this process takes place at two levels. In the first one is when the crude fact is expressed on common language, and the second when it is expressed in the scientific language, which is more accurate in the terms it employs and restricted regarding the community of speakers, because it is shared only by the scientific community. But the scientist does not always proceed in this way. The empirical data are often stated directly in scientific language, without the middle step of common language. That is why Poincaré asserts that the scientific fact is the translation of the crude fact into a more convenient language. In general, the scientist does not say, I see a spot of light in the galvanometer scale. Rather, he says, the current is passing on the galvanometer. This is a scientific statement that translates the observation into a language beyond the sense impressions, transforming these ones into a relevant record for science. So, beneath a substantialist appearance, scientific language expresses the relations among crude facts, and these relations are what the facts have in common and what goes beyond their individual features. So it refers to a system of relations which is not arbitrary and consequently not reducible to a mere nominal construction pointing to intervention. To illustrate this aspect, Poincaré refers to the example of the eclipse. He says that the scientist states that the eclipse happens at a certain hour. This means that in the scientist's clock, it is exactly that hour, which could be alpha. And this also means that that clock marks another hour at the moment of the last transit of the meridian of a certain star that we take as origin of our right ascensions, that is, as our astronomic coordinate system. And also that this clock marks another hour at the moment of the preceding transit of this same star. These all are three different facts, and every one of them composed at least by two crude facts, being one, the hour marked by the scientist's clock, and the other by the transit of the meridian of the star. However, to determine the instant in which the eclipse happened, what the scientist takes into account are not the three different measurements of the three different moments, but only the relation established among them that gives a result, as a result, the scientific fact that the eclipse happened at that precise hour. That is, the scientific fact asserted in the statement, the eclipse happened at this hour. In short, the scientific fact refers to a plurality of crude facts. As Poincaré says, every scientific fact is formed of many crude facts. But the simple accumulation of facts without being organized is not a science. Science is built up of facts, as a house is built of stones. But an accumulation of facts is no more a science than a heap of stones is a house. The scientific language makes a kind of synthesis of experimental data. And in that frame, that shapeless set of data achieves the shape of science by bringing them together in the more convenient way in order to get a better understanding. But this convenience is not incompatible with a feature of every statement about facts. Those statements are always verifiable. As Poincaré asserts, when I am asked, is it growing dark, I always know whether I ought to reply yes or no. This means that beyond the typical linguistic conventions that every language possesses, there is a semantic connection among language and facts. That connection does not exist in those statements that are merely conventions, such as in geometrical conventions. The statement of a fact is always verifiable, and for the verification, we have recourse either to the witness of our senses or to the memory of this witness. As a result, and contrary to Leroy, scientific facts are not made by the scientist at will. From his point of view, crude facts, or les données pures, as he calls them, are outside science. They are experiences prior to our conceptual schemes. Experiences that can only provide scattered fragments of the world as a chaotic and shapeless material that has nothing to do with the constitution of science. That is why the scientific fact is a creation for Leroy, and that is why Poincaré states the relevance of the translation. Poincaré wanted to draw a line in order to separate his perspective from Leroy's, and he wants to keep the objective empirical element that ensures the continuity from the crude to the scientific fact by means of language. There is no precise frontier between the crude fact and the scientific fact. It can only be said that such a statement of a fact is more crude or, on the contrary, more scientific than such another. So the language can only establish a distinction of degree among facts that are not radically different. So to conclude, I just want to emphasize some of the ideas that I tried to outline. When we express a crude fact in language, whether common or scientific, we start the process of generalization, because we cannot keep all the shapes contained in individual facts. By means of his specific language, the scientist goes from particular to general. He also needs some other hypotheses that Poincaré calls natural hypotheses, such as the principle of physical induction or any other. But the idea that there is a translation from facts to language allows Poincaré to keep the objective element of empirical facts within the frontiers of science, letting him avoid nominalist or instrumentalist positions. And that's all.
Antônio Augusto Videira, Departamento de Filosofia da UERJ. E no final a gente abre para perguntas.
So good afternoon. First of all, I would like, as I could not be here this opening session, I would like now to thank IMPA for accepting the idea of this symposium and giving us this kind and professional support. Second, I would like to apologize for my very bad English. I hope you can understand me. And the third thing before I begin, our session, Isabel, Maria, and myself, we are conducting a project, a research project in Portugal. We have financial support from FCT, Fundação para Ciência e Tecnologia, and so we have also to thank this financial support. And I have to apologize also because I changed the title of my talk. At the program, there is something about electron. I could not finish this work, and in the place of this, I would like to do some comments about Poincaré and the nature of scientific theory. This work was done with a student of mine, William. He is here. I thank you very much also. Okay. Okay. So actually, the title of this slide is a question. Is this the most important characteristic of a scientific theory? And I, wait a minute, please. Aqui, que eu aperto.
Eu leio.
Yeah. So I'd like to stress this expression here. It's a quotation of Poincaré. We'll have a lot of them here in my talk. So it may be said that scientific theories are of an ephemeral character, but the role of such theories must be taken into account. In a certain way, I think we can say or affirm that one of the most important goals of Poincaré as a philosopher was to give current opinions and arguments in favor of this quotation. So, as an introduction, I would like to show you our objective, our goal in this talk is to describe and understand Poincaré's conception of a scientific theory. And particularly, we'll focus on his conception of physical theory. And I would like to argue in favor of two theses or ideas. So, I think that Poincaré made, at least two things in favor, in order to show that science deserves confidence. For example, Maria told about Leroy. Leroy, as is well known, was a critic of some ideas developed by Poincaré. So, in a certain sense, at the time, science, in particular, physical science was receiving some critics, and Poincaré, in order to preserve science, as I wrote, made at least two things. He argued in favor of the relevance of physical principles for the creation of natural laws, and he tried to prove that the main goal of scientific theories was to make predictions. Well, I recall here that very quickly, and it's as very well known, there were profound changes, in the contents and subject of natural science at the end of the 19th century, which made science to be deeply questioned about its role and its capacity in describing the true laws of nature. Those changes imply that scientific theories are not eternal, but only ephemeral, as I saw before. And, for example, Poincaré said a lot of times that this characteristic, this feature of theory, of scientific theories, can be also understood as the ultimate truth of nature could never be known. I apologize for this very long quotation, but I think that's very important because here we can see and better, and we can read how Poincaré himself described what was going on at that time. And I think here it's also important because he, he referred to the man of the world. He wrote, "The ephemeral nature of scientific theories takes by surprise a man of the world." It's, for me, it's a bit strange. It's, he didn't write the man of the street, but the man of the world. And he continues, "Their brief period of prosperity ended. He sees them abandoned one of another. He sees ruins peeled out, peeled open ruins." So this is a kind of mistress. And for Poincaré, the state of things make that for the man of old, he must believe that science was in a crisis. The crisis in a world we can find in Poincaré's books and articles, as well in others' works written by other physicists at the same time. And he goes on, his scepticism is superficial. So, as I told you before, for Poincaré, science deserves confidence, and And here it's at the end of this quotation, we have also a very important thing that he stressed, that when he compares Fresnel to Maxwell, he says, or he writes, the goal of Fresnel's theory was to predict optical phenomena and not to say what whether if there is an adder or not, or even this adder is formed of atoms or not. No, I will skip some quotations due to the time. Well, in order to show that science is important and can be affirm some things true about nature, Poincaré develops a strategy, and I describe this strategy as the transformation of the quantum of the unavoidable. And for Poincaré, it was very important to show that those transformations were internal. That is a very important point for him, and I think that the second quotation I showed, it's important for him to compare the scientific point of view and the point of view defended by the man of the world, because the man of the world for Poincaré was external to the science. So the dynamics of transformation must be intrinsic to science and not controlled by external factors. Only science could affirm if it failed or not. That is very important in this strategy developed by Poincaré. Here another quotation in order to show that how Poincaré himself described this idea, and it's there are many, in my opinion, interesting things here in this quotation, but I would like to stress the following one. Well, I will read the advance of science not comparable to the change of a city, where old edifices are pitilessly torn down to give place to new, as for example here in Rio de Janeiro, but to the continuous evolution of zoologic types. This is very important, which develop ceaselessly and end by becoming irrecognizable to the common sight or to the sight of the man of the world, but where an expert eye finds always trace of the prior work of the centuries past. One must not think then that the old-fashioned theories have been sterile or vain. So we see that Poincaré is coherent. He tries to always to give place to the old-fashioned theories. And for him, only an expert eye, or I understand this word as only a scientific eye can see the evolution. The evolution is only recognized by an eye who had been trained. I will skip this. As is well known, Maxwell was very important for Poincaré. Maxwell was important for all of them, Boltzmann, Hertz, and so on. And here I would like only to show you that sometimes Poincaré used some words that it's very interesting, because I'm not sure if he could say you employ those words so easily as he did. In order to give us an idea that theories could go even to the intimate relation between optical and electrical phenomena, I find some in some way curious that Poincaré would employ this word. I will return to this idea at the end. So actually I will not do some comments about Lawrence and the electromagnetism. Lawrence is here because now I am approaching the end of my talk. I would like to show that Poincaré, in order to characterize scientific theories, he employed at least two features, and those features are, he wrote a paper in order to celebrate, I'm not sure, I don't remember, but at the beginning of the 20th century, Lawrence made 25 PhD anniversary, something like that. And I think there was a kind of symposium in order to celebrate this year. And Poincaré wrote a paper about Lawrence and the theory of principal reaction. And at the beginning of this paper, Poincaré wrote that scientific theories had at least two features I will show there. But I'm not sure it's only a conjecture. I think that Poincaré could say that scientific theories are flexible, is one of those features. In this paper, in an homage to Lawrence, because Lawrence was a very important theoretical physicist, and he did not belong to any specific theoretical physics, school of theoretical physics. So Lawrence, it's not very easy to label Lawrence, and I think that it's not possible to say that Lawrence had a philosophical position, at least on physical theories on about science. The quotation I would like to show you the paper written by Poincaré, the theory of Lawrence, the principle of reaction, and there we find this sentence. And as I told you before, one of the features that for Poincaré, at least at that time, was very important in order to characterize scientific theories was that they must be flexible, or in French, souple. So for Poincaré, good theories are flexible, those which have a rigid form and which cannot change that form without collapsing really have too little vitality. This is the second feature I find very interesting in French, vitalité. But if a theory is solid, then it can be cast in different forms. It resists all attacks and is essentially meaning remains unaffected. So we can ask how physical theories can be at the same time flexible and solid. It's very common with Poincaré. We don't have a direct answer to this question, but I will try to give an answer. Is this one physical? And of course, here I'm trying to be closer as possible to the Poincaré's thinking about scientific theories. So I'd like to defend that physical theories attempt to describe nature, which seems all is complex, those draw mathematical language as well as to predict new events. They are always subject to revision and empirical tests. They are contents expressed in mathematical equations. Those equations show the presence of relations which remain invariant. The invariant relations constitute what Poincaré called reality. For Poincaré, theories that are not good cannot survive. They not remain forever. And finally, a scientific theory is solid if it can resist all attacks. In this case, the essential sense, the core of the theory, remains the same. In a certain way, this is a resume of some ideas. But Poincaré knew that nature was much richer than our own imagination, as you can see here. How varied soever the imagination of a man, nature is yet a thousand times richer. To pursue her, we should take paths that have been neglected, and this will often conduct to summits, hence new landscapes will be revealed. I think that is very important to show the sentence, because I think that for Poincaré, at least at the end of his life, to predict something was very important, because we could find new landscapes, so we could have new discoveries. Poincaré thought that Lorentz theory as an example of a flexible scientific theory, but it is very important to stress, as is often in Poincaré's writings, he did not explain how to construct flexible theories. Flexibility is a criteria then can label theories after empirical examination. So we can know that scientific theories are flexible only after empirical examination. So it's not easy, or it's almost impossible to have flexibility as a criteria before the beginning to do to model nature. And now I would like to give a clue in order to understand a little better how scientific theories can be flexible. I think that the principles, as you know, Poincaré discussed a lot about the role principles had in physics, and I think that look at principles, it's possible to understand how a theory can be flexible, at the same time describe reality, and at the same time something of the theory remain after new discoveries. So, in my opinion, theories are based on principles underlying physics. The abandonment of principles should be taken only as an option when there is no other way to save them. So, two more questions. Now, that a bit rhetoric questions, because some I think that both of them are already in a certain way discussed here. And now we have a sort of link between how it's possible to be flexible and at the same time what is the role principle can do in order to make a flexible scientific theory. And Poincaré wrote in this article, it's a very important one in order to understand his thought. He wrote that frames or principles that compose concepts and theories then have not broken because they were elastic. So flexibility in a certain way is due to the principle. Principle cannot be rigid, or at least extremely rigid. But they have enlarged. Or our fathers who established them did not work in vain, and we recognize in the science of today the general traits of the sketch which they trace. So we have here the same idea of a prior quotation. It's always obligatory to recognize traits of the science of the past. And another quotation, the second one, principles usually survive the demise of theories and are responsible for the continuity of scientific growth. And in a way, it's a summary of some ideas I discussed here. I will read in order to spare time. Flexibility is what enables scientific theories to be close to the real world. In a certain sense, flexibility preserves equations of being damaged by experiments. Ces équations expriment des rapports, et si les équations restent vraies, c'est que ces rapports conservent la réalité. According to Poincaré, the objective reality is located in the harmony represented by mathematical laws, and flexible theories are adapted to embody laws, so they can describe the natural phenomena. And finally, as a short conclusion, scientific theories should be flexible so they can adapt to the various objections that are imposed by new experiments. Furthermore, theories have an ephemeral character, and if they survive empirical tests, they are able to develop all the virtues that were latent in them. This is Poincaré's idea. In a certain sense, Poincaré knew that reality became a riddle for scientists. Therefore, science must renounce and desire to be defined. This explains why flexibility became so important to him. It permitted science to be linked to the reality, or nature. Indeed, transformation is constitutive of science in its endless search process of describing the world. So, it's all. I thank you very much for your attention.
So, questions or comments?
It's for you.
My question is about the translation of crude facts into scientific facts. I wasn't sure if I heard correctly that the scientific facts are prior to our conceptual schemes. But I'm not sure I can understand the translation of crude facts into scientific facts other than by their expression in principles that give them a kind of scientific meaning as more or less as implicit definitions, right? So for example, there's crude facts about force, right? And then the translation of that into Newtonian language isn't merely the definition of force in Newton's view, but the expression of the behavior of force as a quantity that appears in the laws of motion. Right. So I would think of that as a translation that sort of gives the crude fact a kind of systematic character by embedding it in a principle. Is that a fair characterization? Or I would have thought that was an example of the translation of a crude fact into a scientific fact by its elevation by means of a scientific principle, which expresses this, which translates this crude fact into a kind of scientific generalization and reveals its meaning in the whole system of Newtonian mechanics.
So, is the
my question was whether it, well, exactly how the translation into scientific language works. Right. In any situation where the, yeah, I think we traded the good microphone for the bad.
Tell me.
My question is how to understand the translation of a crude fact into a scientific fact, and whether principles such as laws of nature or the group theoretic character of displacements play an essential role in making a scientific fact out of a crude fact.
So how can we make the translation? Well, let me think a moment. How can I express this? Well, we receive the crude fact by means of our sense impressions, but we are embedded in a conceptual scheme. So we use this conceptual scheme. So we just need to express it in a language, and this language is dependent of certain conventions and certain things that are not conventions. For example, the concept of group is not a convention, Poincaré. So, well, because you are not I wanted to stress a kind of empiricism, but it's not empiricism as, for example, in Locke. You born with. I think that from Poincaré's view, there are some a priori concepts. For the idea of a group, for example, is a priori. So you made a translation using all your conceptual scheme.
No. Thank you.
Question in most the same direction. When Poincaré says that scientific facts are not constructed, I'm not really sure in what sense was Leroy using the phrase constructed. That's okay. One doubt.
Yeah, that could be a problem. Yeah.
Okay, and another one is the following. I mean, okay, there is a translation from crude facts to scientific facts, but did Poincaré ever attack the question or think about the faithfulness of said translations? I mean, you have crude facts, and you might have several translations possible, and those several translations might come from different theories. So principles and theories somehow will determine the way you translate those crude facts into scientific facts. And then, if the translations are not faithful in some sort of way, then you might not be able to pass from one translation to another, and you will have some sort of incompatible theories. I don't know, that's the...
Okay, well, regarding the first question, when I say constructed, I mean created. Okay, Poincaré wanted to stress that facts are not creation by the scientist. That's specifically to separate his position from Leroy. Because Leroy says the experimental facts are outside science. We experience them, but well, this is a problem to Poincaré because he considers that Leroy took his conventionalist position to the extreme, and he didn't want it to be a nominalist. So just to separate that facts are not created to the scientists. So it was really important to Poincaré, I think, to stress this idea that, well, the scientist does not create the fact. The fact exists. That is why I say that the fact exists independently of the language. So it's a kind of, the fact would exist even if I don't record it, the fact would exist. It's the crude fact, not the scientific. And regarding your second question, well, I think that this has to be with the sense in which Poincaré defines subjectivity. Because you're right that facts can be translated in many ways. But when he thinks about objectivity, he defines it as a kind of intersubjectivity. He says that what is objective is what is common to many thinking beings, and it could be common to all. So, in a sense, there are I think that there are some common structures that can guarantee that we have the same records, even if we translate in another. So I think that the idea of translating some theories that are apparently incompatible is important.
My question or comment is for the three, but essentially for Maria da Paz and for Augusto, because it is very simple. It connects the question of the use of Poincaré, of the word or concept of language and of translation. But it seems to me, it never uses the word concepts, which is used in very much by Marx, for example. And also, in fact, I think we can show, and you have in the first talk showed that what interests Poincaré is the structuration of the theory is a formalism which is structured, and the theory is a formalized structure. Then principles are very important in this formalism, as Guto has told. And so theories are principle guiding, they are guided by principle, but they are made of what? They are made of words, not of concepts. This is the language of Poincaré. I don't, I just try to understand what means this language. Because in my words, it would be theories are made of concept and principles. The fact that Poincaré does not use the word concept, which might be analyzed, I don't know why he does not use this word. Maybe it is because of the question of language was very important at the time, as well as the psychology. And this fact makes that he has a polemics against Leroy. He does not want to say there is no objectivity, the facts, scientific facts, which obviously are worked by the mind, he says explicitly, but they are not constructed, he says. Mm-hmm. They are not constructed. Could he not say they are elaborated? Mm-hmm. They are elaborated with some material, and this material are concepts. He says words. And then saying words, he just has the possibility of translating, exactly, and not of elaborating. And this is, to me, it's not a limitation of Poincaré's epistemology, which it seems to me that we can point at, but it's a limitation of its categories of epistemology in when he uses the word language. Because when he uses the word language and word, he speaks of concept, in fact, but he does not use this. This idea, I don't understand why. If you can clarify this, I don't know.
Perhaps he would like to avoid all kind of philosophical discussions. Perhaps, maybe, I'm not sure, but it's only a hint. Poincaré would like to avoid philosophical discussions because I'm not sure, but I think that at the end of his life, he didn't like to have discussions, at least with philosophical discussions with philosophers, with professional philosophers. In a certain sense, it seems to me that he behaves like Boltzmann or Helmholtz. Professional philosophers, we don't like those guys.
No, but no? They are in different contexts, because Boltzmann and Helmholtz are in an idealist context, if I'm not wrong. And the same with Marx. Marx refuses to be a philosopher.
Marx refuses to be considered as a philosopher. But in France, it is different. The philosophers are very turned towards science, as Bergson told in a famous conference. And so I don't understand. Really, I don't think it is an explanation.
Well, I would just like to say that I don't know why Poincaré does not use the word concept in this context, but I think that the idea of language is really important to him because he wants to keep this idea of translation, and translation is among languages. So, well,
sorry, we have 6 questions, so I think if you want to make all of them, we can't stay discussing with about one
so
question
you,
very long.
You have so to choose the big.
So it's Alain, Reinhardt, Laurent, Gerhard, Philippe.
So I'll be very quick because in a sense, Michel Paty has already said something something like an answer. I wanted to ask whether I'm embarrassed with this. I have a problem with this word language, because a crude fact you say is prior for Poincaré is prior to language. So it means that a crude fact is a pure sensation.
Well,
or is it that he uses language in the sense of concept?
Well, it actually is complicated because sometimes you don't know in Poincaré if the crude fact is pure sensation, is phenomenological, or is something different. It's difficult. I decided to interpret that as an outside language, and it comes into but outside language, prior to language, in the sense that it could happen even if you don't record it.
Yes. Okay.
But not outside science.
And just for Isabel, but it's very quick. For me, it's a question, is it possible to be, also about words, about the word scientist. Is it really possible to be a scientist without having, being inspired by some philosophical thought, even if it's not explicit?
I think so.
A mathematician or a physicist, but a scientist.
Oh, yes, a mathematician is a scientist. I know a lot of.
No, really. And I remember Jürgen Moser telling me, for example, he admired very much Michel Henon because he said Michel Henon is a scientist.
But there are many people that work in science. I don't use scientists.
You work in science that you are a scientist.
Yes. No. We can define the words like that. The words, it's very difficult to use. But in the modern sense, the people that published in physical
that's
review,
a bad sense.
I know some physicists, mathematicians, that they don't know about these problems, philosophical problems. I don't want to do that. I don't want equations. I don't want experience.
Oh, hi, hi.
Very try to very very briefly. We have talked a little about political philosophy so far, especially on Poincaré's part. And if you are talking, where is he, about his optimism with respect to science, this has some connotation, especially for the Vienna Circle people, to connect it also to political opinions, and especially Abel Rey certainly gave it a certain flavor. So maybe you or Laurent can. A little bit more about, because I mean, it's not accidental that he's kind of opposing Leroy, and also that Duhem, who was kind of a neo-Thomist later on at least, and that he was not so much received later on by the Vienna Circle people.
Okay, but in the case of Duhem, I think it's a moderate optimist about science.
Yeah, he might be. So it might be even a contradiction, but still there might be connections, connections between optimism in with respect to scientific and with respect to societal developments. Because I mean, there were Bergson and so on. They were had certainly certain political opinions
more
as opposed to. Excuse me.
Pessimist.
More pessimist. I mean, as opposed to it. Mm. I mean, it was a big theme with the Vienna Circle.
I'm not sure, but I think that sometimes Poincaré, he was optimist, but at other times, not so much.
Okay, well, okay. Maybe.
I'm not sure.
Do you want to comment?
Laurent would like Laurent. To do some comments, I think, about this kind of point of view.
I'm sorry, I prefer French, okay. And you will prefer it too, I think. En fait, je pense qu'on peut. Enfin, je dis pas qu'on doit avoir une lecture culturaliste ou sociologique de Poincaré, mais dans le même sens, dans le même temps, tout ce qui a été montré en termes de citations par Antonio, notamment, et tout ce qui concerne la controverse avec le roi, on peut la lire aussi en termes de débats politiques et de débats religieux. Et en fait, depuis les années 1870 en France, il y a des thèses qui circulent sur la décadence de la science, qui sont très très fortes. Et Poincaré, dans les textes que vous montrez, il répond indirectement, mais de manière très très claire, à la controverse sur la faillite de la science,
oui,
qui date de 1896. Oui. Et, bon, tu connais bien Antonio. C'est pas inintéressant, bien sûr, de voir d'où vient le roi. Donc le roi, c'est un élève de Bergson, il va lui succéder. Le roi, c'est un catholique. Il a des convictions catholiques qui vont le faire mettre à l'index par l'Église. Et bien sûr, Poincaré, pour autant qu'on puisse le reconstruire de ce côté-là, du côté religieux, il n'est pas du tout sur la même ligne que le roi. Je pense qu'on est obligé de passer par là. Ne serait-ce que le biais de... Alors c'est une autre approche, c'est les endroits où publie Poincaré. Il publie dans la revue de métaphysique et de morale. Et le projet de la revue de métaphysique et de morale, il est bien sûr philosophiquement situé, mais il est aussi sociologiquement et, on va dire, culturellement situé par rapport aux relations entre la science et la philosophie et une certaine manière de faire de la philosophie qu'on veut rejeter. Et notamment, toutes les approches qui étaient un peu antérieures, était plutôt sceptique sur les relations entre science et philosophie. Donc, je pense que ça fait partie du champ et effectivement, les questions politiques, sociales sont pas du tout anodines dans ce contexte-là.
Non.
I thank you very much for a comment and explanation.
Je continue en français parce que je veux citer Poincaré. Perhaps just say in English what it happens. I think there are three distinctions: to veritable crude fact, and scientific fact. And
well, the first I didn't hear the first.
The veritable crude fact.
Okay.
Very distinction is between the veritable crude fact and the crude fact. And the veritable crude fact. This is a most. C'est une expression qui coule pas du tout. Il dit ça parce qu'il sait pas autrement. Je cite, mais c'est un petit peu bizarre comme il écrit. Alors il dit il fait noir. Ensuite il dit donc c'est le premier échelon et ce n'est pas entre le premier échelon doit être subdivisé et ce n'est pas entre ces deux subdivisions que la distance sera la moins grande. Je crois si on dit ça en français, en fait, c'est la plus grande. Voilà. Et d'ailleurs, ça, c'est faussement traduit en anglais. Et il continue. Entre l'impression d'obscurité que ressentent les témoins d'une éclipse et l'affirmation « il fait noir » que cette impression lui arrache, il est nécessaire de distinguer. Voilà. En un sens, c'est la première qui est le seul vrai fait brut. Et la seconde est déjà une sorte de fait scientifique, c'est-à-dire... Voilà, là, il distingue clairement. Il y a une fois l'impression qui est subjective et tout ça, et ensuite l'objectivité était déjà le fait brut est déjà objectif, et ensuite évidemment intervient tout ce que dit Laurent. Mais naturellement, on ne devait pas dire que c'est un fait brut. C'est ça que c'est l'interprétation de Laurent, il est importante parce que Poincaré, un autre endroit, il est très conscient qu'on ne peut pas voir, qu'on ne peut pas avoir l'impression d'un fait. C'est-à-dire, en philosophie, depuis longtemps, on ne peut pas voir un fait, on ne peut pas avoir l'impression d'un fait, c'est ce qu'on a. C'est clair. Mais là, je crois qu'il faut l'interpréter politiquement.
Philippe.
There were
two traditions, the mathematical physics, the tradition of mathematical physics, and the tradition of theoretical physics. And my question is for the three, when you studied the connection between the domain of knowledge in Poincaré's work, when you study facts or when you study physical theory, is this difference between mathematical physics and theoretical physics is relevant? Did you meet him?
I'm not sure that is a unique answer to your question. I would like very much if it would be possible to stress a difference between mathematical physics and theoretical physics. I think that, for example, when Poincaré wrote about Maxwell or wrote a paper in honor of Lorentz, I'm not sure, but I guess that he would like to make a difference between both types of physics. He was on the side of theoretical physics, at least at those moments, a specific moment.
Well, Poincaré lui-même, ou alors du point de vue de ce qu'on voit aujourd'hui, de ce qu'on, du point de vue de Poincaré, parce que ce que un créateur n'a pas de division comme ça, non?
Well, I think that that question was already answered by Michel Paty in his talk, because he said that there are two senses in which we can assert mathematical physics. The first is the formal, which leads to the logical development and the leads to the dynamical systems, and the other is the sense of theoretical physics, which implies physical phenomena. And I think that is the possible distinction. I completely agree with Michel Paty in that sense.
So I think we can have a break now. Thank you. We will come back at 4:00.